Ladies and gentlemen, Warren Vader.
Jack likes to quote something that Orson Welles said to him many years ago about acting. He said, respectability isn't good for the craft. Well, Jack is hugely appreciated for his brilliance playing deranged, demented, disreputable, psychotic, non-respectable characters. But for me, the memorable moments of Jack are often the quiet ones, you know, the ones in which his innate sense of good taste and his modesty and even his shyness, if you will, come out and they reveal themselves and he finds himself really at a loss for words, much as he is now. Look at that. See, he can't say anything. He has no microphone. He's fun to watch. Okay, on a movie, anybody who gets to write for Jack automatically feels more gifted than he did before. A director automatically feels that he knows what he's doing. And to act with Jack makes you feel that it's not really that necessary to get paid. But as one who knows him, both professionally and personally, I can tell you that the care that he takes that makes him the great actor that he is equaled by the care that he takes as a father and as a citizen and as a friend. I know that Orson told you that the first actor to accept a knighthood betrayed his profession. I know that, but you don't really have to accept anything here tonight. Being honored as a great actor here tonight is really not so much about respectability as it is about respect, which is what we all have for you in great abundance. So we want to thank you for the ride so far. We want you to keep having a good time. We want you to keep letting us in on it because it's fun to watch. So let's take a look. Jersey Shore. Everyone in the family fussed and mussed over the only boy in the house. They loved to spoil him. In high school, he was voted class vice president and class clown. The boy was somewhat of an untamed pony. He wasn't ready to settle down, so he hit the open road and he headed for Los Angeles. Well, if you ever plan for motor wins, Jack, take my way. The nights were noisy, the rooms were cheap, and the air bristled with young actors and writers. I'm rooting 66. The connection was electric. Jack lit up the smile and he jumped in with both feet. His first job was in the basement mailroom. From there, he climbed onto the bottom rung of B-movies. Five years of horror movies, followed by 5 years of flower power movies.
I thought we played real bad last night.
I bet you thought it was real psychedelic.
Pretty good grass.
Then, a last-minute call to replace an actor in another low-budget biker movie.
Get your motor running.
But something about this one made it the big one.
Here's the first of the day, fellas. To old D.H. Lawrence.
Indians.
If you wanna be a bird.
The man rode that movie to wherever he wanted to go.
What do you mean you don't make side orders of toast? You make sandwiches, don't you?
I don't make the rules.
Okay, I'll make it as easy for you as I can. I'd like an omelet, plain, and a chicken salad sandwich on wheat toast. No mayonnaise, no butter, no lettuce, and a cup of coffee.
The number two, chicken salad sand. Hold the butter, the lettuce, the mayonnaise, and a cup of coffee. Anything else?
Yeah, now all you have to do is hold the chicken, bring me the toast, give me a check for the chicken salad sandwich, and you haven't broken any rules.
You want me to hold the chicken, huh?
I want you to hold it between your knees.
You see that sign, sir? Yes, you all have to leave. I'm not taking any more of your smartness and sarcasm.
You see this sign?
No, Mr. McCarthy. When the meeting was adjourned, the vote was 9-9.
Ah, oh, come on. You're not going to say that now. You're not going to say that now. You're going to pull that henhouse out when the vote the chief just voted. It was 10-9. Now, I want that television set turned on right now.
You don't need your chair. What you need is a lot. You got to keep those tables and finish your work. Jesuit.
Koufax kicks. He delivers. It's up the middle. It's a base hit. Richardson is rounding first. He's going for second. The ball's in the deep right center. Davidson over in the corner. Cut the ball off. Here comes the throw. Richardson rounding first. He goes into second. He slides. He's in there. He's safe. It's a double. He's in there, Martini. Look at Richardson. He's on second base. Koufax is in big trouble. Big trouble, baby. All right. Here's Tresh as the next batter. Tresh looks in. Koufax.
You need to get bigger, you know? Let yourself go. Get some size into it.
I'd like an answer to the question, Judge.
The court will wait for an answer.
You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
What is it Jack wants us to know? What kind of secret could this man have? He slips us a hint in every character he plays. He's a man without pretense. He's every man. He's us.
First thing you should know about Jack is that in high school he was voted class optimist and class pessimist.
You think of a mural of indelible characters Jack has given us, the dissolute young lawyer and easy rider, Jake Gittes in Chinatown, McMurphy in Cuckoo's Nest. Here's Johnny, the crazed writer in The Shining. And who can forget the over-the-hill astronaut in Terms of Endearment?
Yes, just think. Jack even succeeded where John Wayne and Marlon Brando failed. He turned a big old gut into a fashion statement. The Duke resorted to trusses, Brando retreated to kimonos, but Jack simply let it all hang out. He made guys with a gut glamorous.
When the playwright Eugene O'Neill's daughter, Una, saw Jack play her father in Reds, she wrote to him, "Dear Jack, I don't know how to thank you enough. You have accomplished the impossible. After all these years, you have made me fall in love with my father. Even more important, you've given him a sense of humor."
Mike Nichols said, "You ask any kid, and he'll tell you that Jack is the hippest place in the universe, the coolest place, the independent Republic of Jack."
Stanley Kubrick put it this way: Jack brings to a role the one unactable quality, great intelligence.
When he directed Jack in Pritzi's Honor, John Huston said, "The problem is that everything you do, Jack, is informed by intelligence. And here it's got to be dumb, very dumb. Your character is cunning, but dumb in a pure way. I think you should wear a bad wig."
And what does Jack say? He says, "I like to press on the nerves. I think it is part of an artist's role to subvert the conventional wisdom of the day."
He says, "This business teaches you everything. I love this work. It's dangerous. You give your life to it."
One day while shooting a scene, Jack was thrown from a horse, landed on his face in the dirt, broke his wrist, and cut his lip. He picked himself up, climbed back on the horse, and did the scene again. Later, he said, "I wouldn't have gotten back on that horse if I were a real person."
Picture in your minds those Jack characters etched in your memories and hear these words of Willa Cather: "What is art but a mold in which to imprison for a moment the shining, elusive element which is life itself? Life hurrying past us and running away, too strong to stop, too sweet to lose."
Jack, it all comes down to this. Your peers would say you are the screen actor of our generation.
And your late friend John Huston would add, "He has a fine eye for good paintings and a good ear for fine music, and he's a lovely man to drink with." So, Jack,
here's to you. Thank you.